Same people as last week, but we have a new star here as well. So, you remember me, Tony Jordan, Anna Littman Quinn. We have Will Meyer here as well. Will brings a great perspective, so if you get a break or something, certainly talk to him. Will went to Boston College, interned with us last year, and did well enough that we brought him back on board full-time just a month ago, right?
Yep.
I'll say this now, Will's fantastic, and he did all the things as an intern that we expect of somebody. Put his head down, worked really hard, really personable. One of the things I'll tell you now, which wasn't part of my presentation, is the biggest differentiator for a lot of you will be, everybody who got here to Nicholls College, you should be pretty smart, right? Should be. Everybody who interview, they're all pretty smart. They've all got great GPAs, 3.5 and up typically is the line we usually cut. You've done pretty well in school, right? When you come and you meet someone during an interview, the key thing is that you have good communication skills, right? Biggest thing for me. I know you're smarter, right? And so when you come in, I want to make sure that you can talk to me. If you can't talk to me, you can't talk to my clients, right? If you can't talk to me in an interview, then you have a hard time on the job explaining to me what you've done or trying to come to me with questions, right? And so Will does a lot of those things, and obviously, as does Anna, I said nice things about her last week already, so. All right? Me, I don't know any of that stuff, so I'm just here for the pure comedy part of it, apparently, because I can't do my slides right here. Let's see if this works now or not.
Nope.
Block this up?
Yeah.
So it happens when the partner talks too much.
We're going to need you.
Will's also from Chicago, so if you have any questions about the Cubs or anything, make sure you ask him.
Good time to be alive.
Yeah? Here we go. All right. Does that work this time? No? Maybe? No wonder why you gave me this. Is it? Alright, so what are we going to do today is we're going to talk to you a little bit about the fraud triangle, which we didn't talk about last week. We focused a bit more on some general stuff around what we do in litigation support. We talked about forensic technology. Those things will come into play though. We're going to talk about two case examples, and we're going to break into groups when we do that and walk you through a couple case studies, right? I'll tell you ahead of time, these are cases that I've actually done. The names have been changed and everything else, but it's actually two cases that I've worked on before, so hopefully you'll be able to show me where I got things wrong or an easier way to do it, all right? So it should be fun.
And we have lots of goodies here, too, for participation, so koozies, some candy, pens.
Cups.
I think they glow in the dark.
Just watch out. Professor Armstrong will steal them all if you don't take them ahead of time, so be careful. All right. So, three conditions are usually present in a fraud situation. What are those? Anybody have an idea? You probably have the slide in front of you, so it's not very fair, actually.
Don't look at the slide.
Go to the slide.
Has anyone heard of the fraud triangle before?
No?
No? Anybody?
Oh, see one back there. No? All right, the fraud triangle talks about the three conditions that are typically present, okay? So we have one, management has an incentive or is under pressure. Any idea what that means? Yeah?
So usually like they'll get a bonus or something for doing well, like there's a monetary incentive.
Yeah.
Or they say, okay, if you do this however well, we'll promote you faster, etc.
That's right, you have a hand back here too? I saw another hand. Don't lie to me. There you go.
Yeah, I raised it, but it's pretty much the same thing.
He stole your answer?
Yes.
All right. That's certainly one, right? What's pressure? Yeah?
Under pressure to meet a deadline.
Could be a deadline. That could be one thing, yeah. Anybody else?
Meet a certain quota.
Meet a quota? Why would you think, Phil, you need to meet a quota?
Because it's mandatory to meet quotas, I suppose.
Why is it mandatory? Company sets that goal, what might happen to you if you don't help set that goal?
Get fired.
That's right, right? So it could be, you're not even the person necessarily that is pushing it, right? It could be that the CEO says, I need $10 million of revenue and I need it now. And you say, well, we don't have the revenue, right? And he's like, well, I don't care, book it. And you say, well, I can't do that, we don't have revenue. Well, you know what? Maybe you should do that or you might not be here anymore, right? I run into lots of people during my career who made the mistake of booking that revenue, right? Somebody in this room will be in a situation where somebody asks you to do something on a job that you don't agree with, right? And your answer on that is no, and you need to walk away. Because what you don't want is having Anna and Will and me come in and do an investigation and someone saying you were complicit in that fraud and having to make the determination that you have to be fired, right? Now that's on your resume. Or worse, you actually helped perpetrate the fraud by doing those things and now the government comes after you and says, you know what? You actually signed that journal entry that bad entry. You're the one who did it. We don't care that the CEO told you to do it. You had a duty not to do it, right? So a little bit of a scare tactic, but it's true. It happens all the time, right? There you go. Here's my scare trade for a second there. The opportunity exists for a fraud to be perpetrated. And you know what that means? How could the opportunity exist? Yeah?
When a boss actually tells you that you need quota and there's an opportunity to forge the books, say that if you get it out of the warehouse, it will count as revenue and it will go into the books and you just mark it down as revenue even though you didn't sell it.
Yep. So the boss tells you to do it. There's that pressure there. You know no one else is watching over you. And so, yeah, sure, I'll do it, I guess. I have the opportunity to do it, right? That's one way. What else? Anybody else?
like a loophole in what you're doing?
So yeah.
If like a company's making extra revenue and then their boss tells you, I'll mark it less and then put it on the side or something like that. Just like a loophole.
A loophole, right? What we typically call that is a breakdown in internal controls, right? The reason why you see so much of a focus put on internal controls now in audit work is because that is typically why a fraud is able to exist, right? We either have a complete breakdown of internal controls that allows something to slip through the system, or we have a management override of controls in the situations we get in. So right now, I think I talked about last week, we have this president of a company that said, yeah, do the transaction. People sitting in India, not actually making the payment for the bribe payment, they're not going to say no when the president of the company says, make the payment, right? So that's management override of controls. No matter what controls they had in place, as long as that president is there pushing the button saying, you do this, it's going to happen, right? So it's typically an internal controls thing. The other thing I'll say is that typically what happens is we get involved in lots of situations where a company grows really quickly, right? Imagine a company makes, think of something, what do you want to make?
What do I want to make?
Yeah, we're going to make something, some kind of product that we can shove out the door. What do you want to make?
Let's say 30 million. Not
not money, actually a product.
Oh, a product.
Yeah.
Cups.
Cups?
Yeah.
All right, cups.
All
right. Right? So we have some great new cups that we're making, right? You give him one, he's making them. He doesn't actually need them, he's making his own cups.
we're giving him models.
There you go. So a company's making cups, right? These great cups that go out the door and keep things hot, keep things cold, whatever. And they start and they're selling $50 million a year of cups, right? Well, within a year, they're up to, skyrocketing $100 million of revenue. So when that happens, where are they spending their money? Where are they investing in? Plant to make more cups. Machinery to make more cups. Salespeople to sell the cups. All those different things. Are they necessarily looking and saying, we've got some accountant from a $50 million business, but we don't have an accountant that's ready to handle a $100 or $200 million business? Are they thinking about, we've got two or three accountants, and we might need 10 accountants now because of the size of the company and where we're going? No. Do you think we're given skill sets because of these tax issues, because we're going overseas and everywhere else? No. Right? And so now you get a situation that's right because you get people who are not prepared to deal with a company of that size and put the right controls in place. Those are lots of situations we see. We don't only see fraud. Sometimes we see situations where just somebody got it wrong because they didn't have the wherewithal to identify it. Okay? Again, opportunity exists because controls aren't there. All right, eventually they get this to work. All right. Last, the fraudsters rationalize their fraudulent acts. Any ideas on how people might rationalize it? Yeah?
So they tell themselves it's not a bad thing, it's actually a good thing.
Yeah?
So everyone else.
That's right. Yep, that's a great example. Anyone else?
How the Wells Fargo workers, their fraudulent accounts, they wanted to keep their jobs, so they said, oh, if I don't meet this quota, I'm just going to make these fraudulent accounts.
Yep. Yep, that's right. Keep my jaw, kind of pressure and rationalization go together there. You have any answer?
I guess they can just spin it to make it sound right. You know, they could think that they were doing something right in a way, but.
Could, right?
But underlying they knew it was wrong.
That's right. That's a great example as well. So you all hit some great points there, right? And I'll give you a couple examples. Several years ago now, I did an investigation at a very big pharmaceutical company, okay? And they had a CEO of the pharmaceutical company. They were building a new campus for $45 million. CEO made $1.2 million a year in base salary, made more money in bonuses and things like that, right? He had a house in Chestnut Hill, had a house up at Killington because he liked to ski. And what he did was he went to a company that was building this new campus and said, here's what I want. I want you to take $5 million and do this work on my houses in Chestnut Hill and up in Killington. And the construction vendor said, whoa, I can't do that. That's this company stuff. They're doing this for the company. And he said, listen, you want the contract or don't you? If you don't do it, then here's what I'm going to do. You're not going to get the contract. So he goes ahead. When we actually caught him in the fraud, he said, listen, I make so much money for this company, I deserve that. $1.2 million a year in base salary is not enough. I deserve that. Right? This is what I was expected to do as a CEO of this company. I mean, that's what he said. Right? So he completely rationalized. He was so important to the company that he felt he was worth more money, and so he was just going to take the money from the company. Right? See stuff like that all the time. Right? Other people will do what you said, which is, you know, it's for the good of the company. If I don't do this, the company might fall on hard times, so we got to make sure we meet that quota, combination of what you both said there, right? And so I'm really just helping everybody out because we've got 2,000 employees here growing fast, and we don't meet the quota, what happens? The market reacts because we don't meet our numbers, right? And then all of a sudden, five people have a job. So I really need to do this. And some people really think that way. They're not doing something that they think is really bad. They're helping people out. Any other examples you guys want to give?
Yeah, another rationalization is this company makes so many millions of dollars. If I take $100, $1,000, they won't notice, it's just a drop in the bucket. That's kind of how it starts, and then it builds up.
So this all comes from what they call SAS 99, which deals with fraud. It's now changed into the PCAOB guides. I'm not sure what it's called, but whatever.
No.
It's all from SAS 99 initially. Has that changed? Do you know, Jeff? I don't know.
It has, but I'll deal with public companies.
Yeah, that's good.
PCAOB, but there's been a couple of other SASs after that.
Yeah. All right, we talked last week about this, stages of an investigation. I'm not going to go into too much detail here, but we talked about how it's a circular thing and it can start over, right? So we start with scoping the engagement, doing lots of data gathering, then moving on forward into doing some beginnings of an investigation, from that having some preliminary findings, and then making sure we do targeted interviews with folks and learning some more. And then using that information now, do some additional investigation to see if what we learned during interviews and over here really makes lots of sense, or maybe there's more we had to do. And then say, okay, based on all that, where are we? And then potentially starting over, because we may have found additional things, and say, oh, okay, I only thought I had one issue, and now I've got five issues, so I got to start all over again and start scoping these three, four, five other issues and going through the process again. This time frame can take a week or two, or it could take over a year for Anna, sorry, something Anna's working on. So it's a very evolving process. Comments, anyone? Don't feel like you have to say something, but I'll give you the opportunity.
So kind of the case study, we'll kind of walk through this whole process, so you'll get a feel for what each of these pieces mean.
You'll be experts by the time we're done, all right?
Be able to plan your own investigation.
Give you a special certificate on that. All right. Oh, boy. Getting there quick.
Yeah.
So what are we trying to find out when we're doing a forensic investigation? Right? I always break down forensic accounting into three things. When people ask me what I do, I say three things that I'm trying to do. What happened? Who's responsible? How'd they do it? Right? Really simple. One thing that's very important with all this, and we'll go through all this in a second, right? Is I also tell my clients, there's really a fourth thing I sometimes put down here that I have as a sub-bullet, and that is the worst thing that can happen, right? So my clients, I have an odd profession, right? Your clients ever want to see you, Anna?
No.
No. Right? Our clients see us because they have a problem. they have a fraud that occurred or alleged fraud, some problem, right? So we're kind of the firefighters of accounting. We go in and we solve their problems, right? But they only want to see me once. They never want to see me again. Because if they see me again, that means they have another problem, right?
The number of times I've been told, you know, it's nice to meet you, like, you did a great job, I hope I never see you again.
Yeah.
And they're serious, and that's fine.
Yeah, they are serious. And you can't feel bad about it.
Yeah.
I had a client, and this really goes back to, I had a client, right, called PictureTel, a public company, years ago, I did an investigation there. And when I was there, what happened was, the company stole all kinds of stuff. And once they started following up and saying, hey, we got these receivables that are getting really old. Customers weren't paying for certain things. They call the customers. The customers say, a salesperson told me I didn't have to pay for that piece of it. Because he said, just do this because I need revenue, but you don't have to pay for that. Right? Problem, right? Big problem. But as they did that, what they would do over time is they would take it and they'd issue what's called a credit memo and reverse the receivable later on. Right? So what happens when you reverse a receivable? You're reversing the receivable and hitting bad debt expense, or maybe sometimes reversing revenue, depending on the situation, right? So as we finally found all these problems and we had to do a restatement, I went back to them and I said, listen, for the last 2 years, you have all these credit memos that you issued, and you reverse revenue out. So when you do a restatement, I go back and I say, okay, I shouldn't have booked revenue here back in, you know, 2010, and so therefore I'm reversing revenue from here, fine, and I fixed all the books going back in time. Well, the problem was, imagine this, in 2010, they shouldn't have taken revenue, but sometime in 2011, they issued a credit memo that backed out revenue. So I have to back out both. I have to reverse the revenue from 2010, and I also have to fix that credit memo that already reversed revenue out in 2011. So I sat down with the company and explained this to them. So 2 months after they restated their financials to the SEC, I had one of the lawyers call me. He said, Tony, you would never guess what happened. When they did the restatement, they didn't take into account that they had these credit memos, and I go, Mary Jo, please don't tell me that they took these credit memos where they had reversals and they didn't fix them. And she said, how did you know that? I said, because I told them to fix that and they must not have done it. So fine. Long way of saying, one of our jobs is to make sure that, one, they get it right, but two, that they don't repeat the mistakes as they go forward, right? Because they're in control of the poor, because they didn't have good accounting folks listening to what the LC told them to do, they perpetuated those mistakes over time. So I tell my clients all the time, the biggest mistake that can happen is that I come in, I do this investigation for you, we fix it, and then you have another problem down the road, whether it's something as simple as we talked about or another investigation, okay? So real quickly going through this, so in terms of what our goals are, what happened, so there's an allegation, did it actually happen, right? I talked to you last week about the example where somebody said a bunch of product was shipped off site, and we had a kind of a quick way to get around it and say, were there any trucks moving out of the business, any transportation costs, et cetera, right? So in that one, let's use a unique way to find out if that really could have happened or not. So first thing we're always saying is, all right, there's an allegation, is it true or false? Why do you think we have to figure out, why do you think that we can't automatically assume that an allegation is correct? Why? Yep, that's true. We actually waste our time and the company's money, right? But why might somebody put an allegation out there that might not be true? Yep.
Because their perspective of the allegation could be different.
Yeah.
Like what actually happened.
That's right. They might not have all the knowledge, right? So they might think something's bad when it wasn't in the back, yeah?
They might want to harm the organization.
Might want to harm the organization. Why might they want to do that? Personal vendetta, maybe, right? That's a good reason. Anyone else? Same, yeah.
Competition,
yep.
Yeah,
all good reasons, right? And so we see situations where somebody got fired. You know what? Now they're angry. That company sucks. They fired me. Who the hell think they are? I'm going to cause them a problem, right? So sometimes we're having to go through that to try and prove out that that actually didn't happen in some cases, right? Sometimes a competitor might feel something. As someone said, and then other times I've had situations where a short-selling hedge fund actually was trying to attack a company and trying to get the stock to go down because they shorted the stock and they would therefore benefit. And in that case, we actually got the SEC to go and investigate the hedge fund, which was a lot of fun for the scumbags. So anyway, not that I feel strongly about this.
So, you guys all heard the term whistleblower before. So there's this new somewhat new law in the past couple of years out that if you blow the whistle on a company and then they are able to use what kind of information you gave them and it ends up being true and they use your information, whatever the penalty they give to the company, you get a piece of that. So let's say it's $100 million penalty to the company, you get 10% of it, so you go home with $10 million. So isn't there kind of some incentive there to, well, this looks a little shady, I'm going to, you know, blow the whistle on this, maybe I'll get some money out of it.
And you can get up to 30%.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And sometimes the fines are in the billions, so.
Who's responsible, right? Real simple. We're trying to find out who did it. And why would we do that? Because we're trying to find out if it was just a breakdown in control, or it's a mistake, like I talked about earlier, where company's just growing too fast, right? Or is it really that we've got somebody really bad in the company? Because again, going back to my last point of, you don't want it to happen again, if the CFO was the person who's a really bad person and perpetuated this problem, one, we want to make sure we looked at all the things that the CFO did, so we can see where else that he or she may have done things, right? That's the very, very important. Two, we don't want the person in the entity anymore to continue to do that down the road, right? So those are the main things that we're trying to find out, was it an error or was it fraud? If it's intentional, who's involved? And so oftentimes what we do is we do what we call ring fencing, right? So if I had an investigation last year that had a company that had a problem in Mexico. While we couldn't figure out who was really involved, we knew there's one person that oversaw that business from a U.S. standpoint, from the management team. And so we had to also look at the other facility that he was in charge of. So we had one in Poland, another one in Brazil, that he was also in charge of to make sure that he wasn't replicating the same thing there, or at least to figure out if he was involved or not, right? Because the last thing the auditors want, the last thing that the company wants, the board wants, is a bad person staying in there infecting the rest of the company, okay? So that's a, and also just trying to figure out all of the people that were involved. So if I have an email that says Anna was doing something wrong, well, I want to know, was she doing that with Will, or was she with other people too, right? Because I want to make sure I get everybody and I contain it to make sure that we captured everybody that was involved. Capture's part of that word. We identify. I'm not capturing anybody in my investigation. Sometimes, I'm not with the government anymore. And lastly, again, how did they do it? What was the scheme? Did we really capture everything? I talked about that. We used to capture again, didn't we? And then, you know, how do you stop it from happening again? What controls do we need to put in place? Right? Does that make sense? Real simple at the end of the day. Questions? All right, we'll see you later. We're out of here. You do a case study all by yourself. That's the quickest thing, like 10 times to get to work. All right, so, since you are experts and you have no questions, we're going to start with a Ponzi scheme case example. And in this case, we are, one, going to determine what individuals we'd like to interview as part of our initial scoping, and also figure out what we want to ask them. We'll give you some facts beforehand, so you have some facts. And then two, determine how to approach the victims of the fraud. Full disclosure, this is a case that I worked on when I was at the Securities and Exchange Commission, so it was an interesting one, where there were 142 victims of the fraud. That number will always stick in my head, and I had to meet with every single one of them. I'll explain some more facts about it afterwards to give you a sense. And then, based on certain facts that we'll give you, we'll determine how to go about identifying how much was taken and from whom. So in this case, I actually had to go and figure out all the money that was stolen, one, so they could put the person in jail. Because the federal sentencing guidelines looks and says, if you stole this much money, 5 to 10 million, it's this many years in prison, right? If it's 10 to 20 million, it's even this many years in prison, et cetera, et cetera. All right, so based on how much you stole is what the sentence is usually based upon. And for whom? Because the extent that the government we could get money back, we had to figure out who to distribute it to, right? So if everybody in this room was one of the victims, and you had 10%, and we were able to get $100 million back, well, you would get $10 million of that money because you had 10%, right? Potentially. All right? Setting this up. Well, you can go over the facts first. Don't you go over the facts first? Yeah. I probably mentioned this case last week a little bit, but we'll go through it. Brad Strongarm, very, very closely related to your professor here. has been running a successful investment advisory business, Strongarm Financial Planning, for over 30 years. All right? Mr. Strongarm called you. He didn't call you. All right. You got a call from the Attorney General's office indicating they received an audio tape from Mr. Strongarm claiming that he had been stealing money from clients for at least 20 years and that he was committing suicide. Did I tell the story last week? This gentleman went to try and commit suicide, and I was working at the SEC, and we got a call from the FBI that they had gotten one of these tapes, by the way. And when he went to go commit suicide in his garage via carbon monoxide poisoning, it was dark because he had the lights off and he was drunk, and he slipped, and there was a pool table in his garage, smashed on the pool table, and cracked a vertebrae in his neck. And so when they showed up that morning, the police come find the dead body, he was paralyzed on the floor. So he knew how to steal money, but he did not know how to commit suicide. And so he was in a hospital, and somebody came to me and said, Tony, we need an affidavit to show that he was actually doing what he said he was doing in the tape. And as he was walking out of the hospital in a halo with his attorney, because he started to get feeling bad, he was arrested and put in jail. And so hence his story started there. So that's how he got introduced to that case. In any case, the AG's office in this case has asked Nichols Forensic Accounting Advisors to investigate to determine the following: how much was stolen, who at SFP was involved, and where did the money go, and is there any left to refund the harmed investors? All right? We should probably break up into to groups of about 4 to 5 people, I think, and then we'll get started with the case study. So if you could just kind of congregate with some different folks, it's up to you. I don't know, Professor Armstrong, if you have any suggestions, but we're going to do this together. And so each of the things, we're going to have you meet amongst your group, and then we're going to share some ideas.